I got this, Jesus. Don't worry. Yeah, it's good to step into the therapist's shoes like that, right? And Jesus has this intense focus on making sure, insisting that we don't put him higher than us. Because he says it's really, really bothered him that we put him in this pedestal as greater than us. So he's so focused on insisting that we not do this. And so I'm on board with that. Yeah, I'm on board with that. Absolutely. It's just like I say, I could hang with the Beatles at this point. There's no doubt about it. I could hang in terms of songwriting. I could hang in terms of instrument playing, and hang in terms of vocalization. No question about it. Let's go. Except I don't need to. I don't need to. I don't necessarily want to. I don't need to. And so I probably won't do that. Yeah. But hanging with Jesus is more interesting. And more to the point, I feel that the teachings of the past are not up to speed with the current times. And they're not. So I'm just helping them get up to speed right now. This isn't, the 19th century or 2,000 years ago, not even the 20th century anymore. This is the 21st century we're living in. And the future is not what it used to be, to say the least. And we're under unprecedented situation now, totally unprecedented, with this global village and big pharma now having five generations, marketing to five generations continuously. This puts just such a different spin on what's going on here. I mean, the basics are the same, but the difficulty has certainly changed. Certainly, certainly changed. And so I'm just all about that. I'm all about being contemporary and finding contemporary solutions to contemporary problems. And we are facing extremely difficult problems in the world to remain properly oriented towards exchanging logic for reason. I mean, it's still the same situation, except the invitation to fail is incredibly severe right now. Incredibly severe. Frighteningly severe. So that's why I'm like, my hair's on fire. The stuff previously never even mentioned any of this kind of stuff. The one that did the best job is Ram Maharshi, for sure, and we super grateful that he has supported us in that way. He did address the modern world, and he said, all these inventions and such can go on forever. They're meaningless. They don't mean anything. They're all just a play of your imagination. It's just a fantasy, and pay attention to it. There's nothing there. There's nothing there, actually. But he did address that what was going to happen. He did. So it's extremely helpful. He other addressed certain other issues, too, which are extremely important right now also. So Big Pharma has been shaping this discouragement ritual in the world. There's the ultimate goal is we believe that we're going to find a way to disable perfection within this first half of this century, you might say. This is the intense belief in the world, and this is why this world has attracted so many people into the world now. A certain type of person, very much discouragement ritual loyalists, have come into this world, and they're saying, "Don't worry, we got this. We'll bring the tech in." That's why tech came into this world. Tech, just kaboom. Right? I mean, roots started growing in the late 50s and through the 60s, and then the 70s, kaboom, and then it's just been exploding. And now, we're at the point where you can see what's going to happen. I certainly can. And it's not a joke. They didn't have that stuff back then. So talking about this, people would say, "What are you talking about? You're crazy. You're just utter science fiction maniac. What are you talking about?" Well, it's here now. It is here now. And so it's just the intense invitation to fail, to continue to wait for what can never happen, is unprecedented at this point. So I have to respond to that. I can't be responding to the 18th century or something like that. That makes no sense at all. I mean, the ways that they used back then may not be the best ways to use right now. We're in this super activated time right now. We got 100 plus years of people using drugs to greater and greater and greater. They didn't have those drugs back then. Keep in mind that the drugs we're talking about in this world, we're in 19th century, second half of the 19th century, the cocaine and heroin were synthesized the way we have them now. And then amphetamines came along in the 20th century. And now we just have all the hallucinogens. LSD came in the 20th century. But we're making all sorts of different compounds, massive compounds. They didn't have that stuff back in the age, back in the days. And they didn't have caffeine to the extent we have it either, or nicotine, etc. This stuff just wasn't around, okay? It wasn't around in the world. We live in a drugged out world right now, that the past simply wasn't this way at all. And the thing with drugs is you can be really high and feel great and functional, and then you can also then flip. You become very bipolar, causes bipolar problems. We're having extreme bipolar problems in the world. You then can become very, very angry and irritated. When the drugs wear off, you need more drugs, you get in between, and it's just, our culture is very easily irritated, and at the same time, also overconfident. Drugs make you overconfident and make you over-irritated also. Both of these things, we have very bipolar world culture at this point, extremely so, extreme mental illness. They simply didn't have this type of situation in the past to this extent at all. Plus you have a whole bunch of really older people and their issues too. You just take right now, and you cannot compare it to some other time in history. You simply cannot, in terms of what we're dealing with here. The past teachings couldn't really talk about this because it hadn't happened yet, and it wouldn't make much sense to anybody at all. But now it is happening. The fire is upon us. There's a huge wildfire, using California language, gigantic wildfire, and it's bearing down on your homes. And you just sit there and say, well, we didn't have wildfires back in the day like this. We didn't have these problems back in the day. Yeah. That's what people are doing. They're in their bed, they're watching the wildfire. What's this? Wildfire. It's a wildfire. Oh, really? It's a wildfire? We didn't used to have these kind of wildfires back in the 70s, in the 20th century. No, we just didn't have these kind of wildfires. Yeah. Let me smoke some more pot, feel good about myself. Yeah. evacuate, get out of the house, get out of the way of the wildfire. I know we didn't have these. This is looking kind of cool. Wow, but we didn't have these back in the day. This kind of attitude is just crazy, okay, to say the least. So, we have to practice in the midst of this wildfire raging in the world. We're going towards putting biosensors in everybody on the planet, and then monitoring their brainwaves 24/7, and then working to sync up these brainwaves in such a fashion that we can try to disable perfection. This is what we're actually engaged in. That's what Big Pharma is a part of this push. They're a central part of this push, and along with the tech people, I call it biotech or pharma tech. Pharma tech. Those two agencies are centrally involved in this whole situation that's going on in the world, and it's just going to blindside everybody. It's going to blindside them, but it's not blindsiding us at all. We're blindsiding it, actually, because it can't believe that it's possible to opt out of this scenario. It is. It's this scenario. This discouragement ritual is entirely voluntary. It's voluntary, not mandatory. It's desire, not need. Voluntary, not mandatory, desire, not need. Voluntary, not mandatory, desire, not need. Voluntary, not mandatory, desire, not need. It's simply a voluntary desire to play with this silly game of trying to disable perfection, believing that perfection is hiding a flaw from us. Once we disable perfection, we'll be able to locate the flaw and fix it. And this will enable us to have this glorious experiencing of being prior to perfection. That's all just a silly whim, desire whim, that has no possibility of ever taking place. And we're literally waiting for what can never happen. But the problem in today's world is because of this, you know, these biosensors that we're going to introduce into our bodies, and the satellites and the GP and the ways that they can monitor this, and the you know, wireless networks, and the quantum computers, and the way we're going to do it is people are feeling like, wow, this might work, this is our great opportunity, we've never had an opportunity like this. So the temptation is infinitely more than any temptation in history right now. Absolutely it is. So that's why it's such an extremely dangerous situation for us here. And that's why I keep saying, hey, gurus, Holy Spirit, you got to step on the gas here. You know, this is not some past time in history we're dealing with. We got extreme problems right now, because people will say, well, gee, I need to wait for this and see what happens. That in itself is, you know, extreme dereliction, because nothing's going to happen. But a whole lot of people are going to be blamed for nothing happening is the thing. We got so much hope that this has to be it. As if all the previous failures means this next step has to succeed, which is absurdist logic. When you're trying to do the impossible, there's no next step that has to succeed. Every single effort is equally futile, but people don't see it that way. So when it doesn't work, they're going to be looking for who is not participating, you know, who is like jamming up the works kind of thing. This is a gigantic problem here going forward here. So, you know, I'm pushing, practicing while in the midst of what we're doing. There's functioning on five different ways simultaneously, which is what we're doing here. Simultaneously, five different ways, at least five different ways. And one is, you know, you're just functioning in a normal way, being a responsible citizen and have, you know, supporting your family, you know, your job, groceries, health, all the whole sort of thing. You're living your life doing that. And then secondly, you're asking and being receiving practices for yourself to use. And then thirdly, you're vocalizing these practices. You're vocalizing these practices. Okay. And fourthly, like I'm taping the practices, I'm sharing the practices on social media, that kind of thing, and then doing all this in the midst of constant shifts and change and challenges and ups and downs and fatigue and all this kind of stuff. And in other words, consistency of practicing, doing consistency of practicing in the midst of all this kind of stuff. And there's you know, just the whole situation, you have to do it all. You have to do it all right now. You have to do it all. You got to just hammer your practicing every day. You got to make it creative. You have to come up with the practice, make it creative for yourself, keep it creative so you keep doing it. Hammer it every day, okay, that sort of thing. Not allow yourself to stall out or quit. Do it in the midst of your busy, busy, busy life. You know, and then also, you know, play the fool. That's the kicker, you might say, which is just act like, you know, not doing anything at all. Don't draw attention to what you're doing, so to speak. Don't draw attention. So I've been working at this so intensely for so long. I can do all of this in the midst of people around me and things happening, and nobody seems to be bothered at all. Because I just don't put out this vibe, like nervous vibe or anything. I'm very respectful of people's privacy and make it clear, you know, that I'm not trying to intrude in their lives. I'm not trying to push anything on anybody. I'm just focused on my thing and doing it. I've been doing this for so much and so long that, you know, I'm able to do this. And people just, you know, they don't give me a second glance or anything like that, because I'm not really asking for anything like that. I'm just a fool, you know. Why just a fool, you know? So why bother with a fool? So, you know, this is what we have to do. This is the challenge we have right now. It's not the old challenges. Stop trying to meet the old challenges. We have to meet the challenge right now. We got busy lives. We have activated lives. We have pressures in our lives. We have challenges in our lives. The future, economically, you know, the inflation, people maxed out with their credit cards. How are we going to financially survive? How are we going to, what kind of housing are we going to have? You know, geopolitically, everything is just like, you know, on us. And then five generations being marketed to with the most greatest possible intensity by Big Pharma, and all their money, that all the savvy that money can buy in terms of manipulating people subconsciously. That's been going on for at least five generations here, intensely. Longer than that, but intensely, you could say five generations. mass marketing. I mean, Germany did it back. Yeah, you know, the Coca-Cola thing in Germany, that was mass marketing to the whole country, and it was extremely successful. And they said, wow, that's amazing that we can do mass marketing to people and get them to buy it. I mean, so this has been the nirvana of Big Pharma, is mass marketing to an entire culture, to the entire world. They're experts at it. They're extremely talented at this. And they've been pumping in, you know, untold fortunes into this for 100 plus years. And of course, Germany then marketed Pervitin, which was, you know, methamphetamine, basically. It's a very powerful amphetamine. To the whole country also. That was also extremely successful. And they used the same tactics as they used with Coca-Cola, introducing Coca-Cola into their country. Of course, negative effects of those two issues, we historically can look back and see that they certainly played a role in creating sort of a bipolar, super aggressive and edgy sort of situation there. It certainly did. And of course, the Germany also invented cocaine and heroin, and was distributing that also, promoting that throughout part of its history, and it's just wow, wonderful world of science, yeah, wow. So we live in this edgy world now. People are on way too many types of drugs. And they have been influenced, their subconscious mind has influenced, it's sort of like there's this complex that the pharmaceutical companies have developed, marketed, in getting us to believe in this idealized complex. Especially if you go along with them, you're being liberated. You come a long way, baby. You know, you're being liberated into who you really are, who you should have always been. So they stole all the spiritual teachings. They studied it. They had their guys study it, the marketing whizzes, study all the spirituality. They were on it and been studying it and researching it, and then using the symbology, spiritual symbology of all this stuff in their marketing campaigns to make you think if you go along with pharma culture, which is what we have, it's really discouragement ritual culture to be microdosing. Everybody be microdosing, mandatory microdosing in the future to get our brainwaves synced up. If you go along with that, this means that you're on the road to Shambhala. You know, you're going to be enlightened. You're on the road to enlightenment. You're finding your true self. So they co-opted spirituality on this planet. Big Pharma did. They absolutely co-opted it. 100% co-opted it. This is why I look at the teachings that we have available in this world. I just say these things are just don't have what it takes, really. They don't really have what it takes. Not nearly emphatic enough. Not nearly clear enough. It's been co-opted by Big Pharma. They're all in on what they're doing. They're all in on it, and they have no scruples whatsoever. They will co-opt anything and everything to funnel us and herd us into this collective ritual of syncing up our brainwaves, and which is really thinking. AI can read brainwaves now and print out text about what we're thinking. Pretty soon we'll be able to just produce videos from our brainwaves, and they'll know exactly what you're thinking in the future here. Everyone's thinking, and they're then going to microdose drugs to alter your brainwaves so that you're thinking in ways that are ideally suited for the ritual. Now, if we know the Bronze Age, like city-states like Athens, Bronze Age, Iron Age, but it had to do with the weapons back then, but like Athens, city-state, in Bronze Age, you could get away with a lot of crime back then, and they kind of like, yeah, whatever. So it wasn't important. The one thing you couldn't do is you couldn't mess up their rituals, their rituals to the deities. You had to do that right. You couldn't play fast and loose with that. If you did, capital offense, death penalty for that. So rituals here have always been extremely important, and we're going into this all-time huge ritual, collective global ritual of syncing up brainwaves. So the microdosing of drugs will be mandatory in this world, and if you don't comply, it'll be a capital offense. Okay, this is where Big Pharma is taking everybody. This is their objective, along with tech. So it's like a herding exercise, herding everyone that's out. And we believe this will finally disable perfection through just intense discouragement. We all say we love this seeking for what doesn't exist. We love this disablement ritual, this disablement we're experiencing. We love it so much that we're never going back to perfection. And we hope to, implode, discourage perfection to such an extent that we can then locate this flaw that we believe it's been concealing from us. Hasn't been concealing any flaw from us. We just desire that there be a flaw in perfection effect so we could experience being prior to perfection in a glorious way. But there isn't any flaw in perfection whatsoever. This, when we choose the idea of being prior to perfection, we experience it in this intolerable feeling of separation. That's the only way this idea can be experienced. We can't experience it in a glorious way at all. But we insist that, yes, we can. The reason why we're not is perfection has a flaw, but we can't locate it. Well, it must be concealing it from us. Therefore, if we disable perfection, we'll find that flaw and fix it and be able to experience this idea of being prior to perfection in a glorious way. That's the ideology, the false premise ideology that this entire situation is based on here. So, we're trying to, get to this ritual where we all finally are able to work together on the same page and get perfection to be disabled, drop its guard enough so we locate that flaw. There it is. We knew we'd find it. So people are just waiting for that. They say, we're almost there. We're almost there. We're almost there. So people here are so in on this. They're so in on this. That's why I haven't gotten any traction in this world. I keep telling you folks, it's not going to work. There's no possibility it works. And you're going to have buyer's remorse, extreme buyer's remorse. Horrible. Horrible, horrible. It's better to find out about this ahead of time than to find out about it later. Much, 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 much better. And so we've been able to do that here. We've been able to do that. We've been able to see, what the game is. Let you know there's no possibility it's going to work. It's all based on a false premise. And it's desire, not need. We don't need to do this. It's a desire on our part. Our participation in this discouragement ritual is voluntary. It is not mandatory at all. They claim it's mandatory, then they threaten you. Say, if you don't participate in this, when we have established the new perfection that's actually prior to perfection, you will be excluded from that. Forever. You have played no part in that whatsoever. You'll be completely cut off and excluded, and completely isolated and all alone forever. That's what they threaten us with if we don't go along with this discouragement ritual. That's the threat that they keep using on everybody. So, of course, people cave in. We cave in because it was like, it's so terrifying. It's like, what if that happens? There's no way it can happen. There's no such thing as a new perfection. There's no such thing as being excluded from the one and only perfection. It's the very nature of inclusivity itself. There is impossible to be excluded from it. So it's a completely idle threat, totally bogus, a made-up idle threat, totally. And yet it's very effective because it's but what if it, I don't want to risk it, I don't want to risk it, I don't want to risk it. And we think, well, I don't have to really risk it, I can just kind of be a little bit deluded. But you can't really be a little bit deluded. It's not possible. You're either deluded or you're not. You either are entertaining logic or reason. Logic says that there's an imperfection. There's an imperfection there. And reason says there is no imperfection in perfection. Zero imperfection. None whatsoever, never can be. And so those two, logic and reason, are incompatible. Totally incompatible. Totally mutually exclusive. Cannot be integrated in any way. Okay? It's impossible. It's like integrating zero and one. There's no integration. Either there's a numeral, there's no numeral. Either there's perfection or there's no perfection. Having an imperfection, perfection means there's no perfection. Okay. So logic plays fast, clever with this and says, well, let's just like take turns, you know. I'll be right, then you'll be right. I'll be right, and we'll both be happy that way. Now you just end up with chaos when you try to do that. Chaos and extreme unhappiness. So both can't be right. Both can't be right. Impossible. Impossible. So during these times, we must focus on reworking our expectations that we're going to shift from logic to reason. We're just going to make that shift. That's all. We don't have to worry about enlightenment, self-realization, actualization, love, peace, anything. None of that stuff. We don't have to even worry about, even think about or talk about any of that stuff. All we're doing is we're shifting from logic to reason instead of taking turns back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, which is logic's enlightenment. Logic says that's even better than enlightenment. Mutual exclusives cannot be integrated. Logic keeps saying, oh, that's integration. No, it's taking turns. So all we're doing is preparing ourselves to shift to reason. Reason says there's no flaw in perfection at all, period. That's all. It knows this to be true. So to do this, you just need simple practices, not complicated stuff. Simple, 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 because all reason says is just there's no flaw in perfection. Perfection is perfect. That's it. It doesn't need to say anything more, does it? That's it. So just yes, 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 yes. That's all you do, gotta do. All I gotta do is just say yes, 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 yes. Yeah. So we're able to do that. We're able to do that. We're able to just say yes, 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 yes. Mm-hmm. Very, very, very yes, yes, yes-y of us. So here we go. Yes, 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 to the 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 yes, yes, yes. Yes, 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 to the 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 yes, 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 yes. And just keep focusing on that. Keep focusing on simple practice. I do not know. I do not know. I do not know. I need do nothing. I need do nothing. I need do nothing. I need do nothing. Nothing ever happened. Nothing ever happened. Nothing ever happened. Nothing ever happened. Equal futility. Equal futility. Equal futility. Equal futility. Yes, 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 yes. I do not know. I do not know. I do not know. I do not know. Just practice this in the midst of your life. So I did these three nature walks today, practicing the entire time, and it was great. It was super beautiful. At the same time, it was super effective practicing, and it was really a huge boost of confidence to be able to do that. And I am swinging a golf club a bit now, seeing if my body can handle that or not, and how the body's going to respond to this push that we're making right now. And we'll see. So far, it's not terrible. I'm certainly feeling severe fatigue at times, but it's not, you know, the horrible PEM malaise, post-exertion malaise. It's not full-on. It's kind of like backed off a little bit. We'll see. I don't want to say too much. I just keep pushing and you know, try to build up some strength here, some flexibility again, get a little bit more shape. So I took a pretty substantial walk today. I don't know how I'm going to feel in the morning from that. That's the most I've walked in quite some time. Lifting things, I'm carrying heavier stuff. I'm trying to be more physical in terms of, you know, effort and things like that, and seeing if, you know, if the body can bounce back. And my diet's pretty darn simple. I'm very, you know, simplified my diet. It's just like just using mostly smoothies for my diet at this point. Smoothies are just the same. It's just only what OYG, only what OWYN, only what you need. A protein drink, OWYN, only what you need, which is pea and pumpkin seed protein with monk fruit extract as sweetener. And I use that as a base, and I put in a whole fat plain kefir. Sometimes, you know, it's organic, sometimes not, but just plain. It's not sweetened or anything like that. Just plain kefir for the probiotics and some, you know, some good features of the kefir. And then in that, I put in organic strawberries and blueberries. Sometimes the blueberries are organic, sometimes not, depending on the price and availability and stuff. And do that twice a day, and that's my food basically at this point. Keep it really simple, just smoothies, and then some cheese. I'll have some cheese in between, sometimes a cheese sandwich. And that's pretty much it, my diet. Because why, strawberries are in season here right now, and they're cheap at Whole Foods, very cheap, extremely cheap, and really, really good. They talk about organic strawberries that are really tasty, and they're really cheap. So I just bought like 6 baskets of them, you know, like, and let's do it. So I'm eating a ton of strawberries right now, so much strawberries, wow. So keeping it simple. And today started out like terrible. Like I thought it'd be like the worst day ever. I felt like this is just, you know, I was in such a bad mood. It was like very rare to be in such a bad mood. But I was able to turn it around, get help, you know, from Grace. I lost my windscreen on my microphone, the mobile microphone. I said, and it was super windy. I said, oh, this is horrible. But I put the microphone, you know, it clipped it and put it inside my shirt, and that blocked a lot of the wind from, you know, hitting it. And the taping turned out really well. The vocals turned out great. I said, I can do this now. That's really helpful. Very, very helpful. It's not as obvious as having that big windscreen on it. You know, you can kind of tuck it under and then nobody hardly notices. So actually it was a win there, big win. And so the wind sort of stacked up throughout the day. Got some help. I had this terrible job I had to do. I've been dreading this for years. Somebody showed up and helped me, hugely helped me. It was a tremendous amount of help, and stuff just got done like that, and it was easy, and it's like, wow. So Grace helped out a great deal on a day which I thought could just be like all-time bummer day and just put me in a tailspin. It turned out to be just the opposite. I actually got more and more traction today, more and more traction here. So that's, you know, beneficial that you have someone here in the world that's willing to say what needs to be said, so you can start, you know, considering, saying, wow, you know, maybe this is voluntary, this situation in terms of participating in this ritual, discursion ritual. It is voluntary. Let's at least consider that. And I read Ramaharshi yesterday. He had a quote I hadn't heard before. And he says, mortality is just an idea that we're having. You can easily give up that idea if you want. Mortality, yeah. Just an idea that we're having. It's just imagination. It's not set in stone at all. Ramaharshi said, I said, wow, that's true enough. That's true enough. And Ananda Mahima said that you can't actually get rid of your habits, you know, by working on them. What you have to do is be attracted to truth, be attracted to whatever you want to call it, the one, the self, divinity. You know, what is that? I don't know. You have to experience it. It's beyond words. So you have to be attracted to, you know, perfection, let's say, and choose that over your old habits. You cannot get rid of your old habits by working on them. She says you can't do it that way. It doesn't work. I'm like, yeah. That's not what we've been waiting to hear. That's like incredibly important information, actually. Crucial, crucial information. You don't need to work on logic. Don't think you can work on logic and perfect logic. It's impossible. Logic's total intrinsic purpose is to promote the belief that there's a flaw in perfection. How are you going to get the truth by working on your logic? How do you perfect that? How do you perfect falsity? You can't. How can you perfect falsity? You cannot do that. So you must be attracted to truth, that there's no flaw in perfection. Be attracted to that and prefer that. You say, you know what, I prefer this over that, so I'm going to be experiencing this idea instead of that other idea. That's how you do it. She says that's how you have to do it. So that is extremely helpful advice from her. You gotta go through it, and I've been for so long I'm trying to get advice from these teachers. You know, it's there. It's just you come upon it when you're ready to come upon it. But it's there. They sprinkle it around, you know, for those who have the ears to hear it. Most people don't have the ears for that. Forget about logic. It's not gonna lead you to satisfaction at all, to a glorious experiencing at all. It just always pushes it off into the future. It's almost there. It's almost there. It always says it's almost there. We're almost got it. We're never. How can you get what doesn't exist? How can you find what doesn't exist? How can you succeed in an impossible quest? You can't. So it's not in the future. It's not anywhere to be located. It doesn't exist. So it's just a useless endeavor, a totally aimless wandering around, meaningless, aimless wandering is all. You know, doesn't go anywhere actually. Doesn't go anywhere, but we keep hyping that we've almost succeeded. We've almost succeeded. There can't be any almost succeeding of an impossible goal. It's zero, just the same as any other attempt. You know, this configuration just got zero potential to succeed. No potential to succeed. But logic cannot see it that way. It will fake it and say, well, I see it that way. What it means is, okay, you had your turn to see it. Reason, you had your turn. Now it's only fair for me to have my turn. Let's take turns. That's its game. That's its trick. It's taking turns. Okay, you had your say. Now I have my say. It loves discussions. Logic is always promoting discussions because it'll say, okay, I listened to what you had to say, reason. Now you have to listen to what I had to say. That's only fair. No, it's completely unfair because it's a complete waste of time. One has to be right and the other has to be wrong. So the idea that we just take turns listening to one another is just complete futility. Complete futility. There can't possibly be any sort of resolution under that sort of taking turns format. Yes, 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 yes. I'm popping out the optimism for you and the encouragement here. And you just, you know, catch the breeze, you know, set your sail up and let the breeze, you know, sail on the breeze of this optimistic clarity that you have, or just sail on the breeze. Sail on the breeze. Golf wise, I was just working on, you know, shot shaping. Can I shape shots? Never been able to really effectively before. And now I kind of feel like maybe tomorrow I'll find out. I think I'll probably go out and to the range and see am I able to shape shots? Driver, you know, can you shape shots from the driver to start with? That's kind of important. I certainly have a reasonable expectation that it's possible, just by the setup, the different setups that I have, and the different swing planes that I'm using. I have absolutely have different parameters. You know, different parameters I'm using for the different shot shapes, a draw and a fade, and so. You know, I'll see if I can get it going. I'll try. I'll give the old college try, you know. And if it doesn't, it doesn't. You know, back to the drawing board. But at least I have reasonable expectation that something might happen. I don't know exactly what. It's hard to draw the ball these days. It really is. That's why most people go to the fade these days, because the modern clubs and this balls and stuff, they don't spin enough off the driver to draw it very easily. You know, the whole idea is low spin off the driver. Seems to be easier to hit a power fade than it is to hit a draw these days. It really is. So if you try to hit a draw, usually you just kind of hit it straight, kind of a straight ball. But I have on occasion come up with a swing that does draw the ball. So I say, it is possible. It is possible. And it's, you know, it's just, yeah. It's about keeping like the right elbow in against the body and using that right elbow as the key and keeping it super close to the body and keeping it real, the club real low. Okay, it's real low plane, real close, right elbow right close to your body, then the turn, and then through and keep the right elbow in there. That keeps an inside to out swing. It doesn't let the club drift out, because if you start let the right elbow get out, it moves the club out. Keep it, you know, inside the entire way like this, and then just, you know, release through it, and then have the club face slightly close to the path of the club. That should produce a draw. You know, theoretically it should. And the power fade's easy. You just left shoulder up, left elbow into the body, and so you want to have kind of an outside swing path. You know, an outside to in swing path like this, cutting across the ball, and you want to have the club face aiming to your target, but your body aligned is open, aiming left to your target, and with that left shoulder, left elbow to the body, and you sort of keep a flying elbow, so to speak. So you make sure you don't get inside the ball. Like that, you want to pull the ball left, start it left, and then let the spin, you know, fade the ball back towards the right. So and the grip, you know, so the type of overlapping grip, so I don't open the club face too much on either one of those shots. I don't want to open it too much. So the grip's important also. So these are just little things that I'll, you know, toy with. You know, I'll change the grip. There's a lot of different configurations you can do with the grip, and maybe one will work better than the other. I just have to see, you know, the elbow thing and the swing plane thing, you know, and the alignment and stuff. Again, I'll just, you know, work with that stuff and just tweak it and see, you know, what we come up with. And you know, but they don't overanalyze the swing. The pros, you know, the television, you do, whatever, they make it so complicated. They make it think like there's a million things you need to do, and I'm working on this. There's just some basic parameters you should know, and then just do little tweaks, you know. But the basic parameters have got to be there. And it's simple. It's simple. Don't want to overthink it. So I don't know. A reasonable expectation. So, but you know, we'll see what happens. I'm not going to try to get ahead of myself. But so things are looking up as the world is really racing towards this situation again of the highest hopes that we're going to come across this unbelievable capability to sync all. Everyone's synced up on the same page throughout the whole planet. That's this whole diversity, equity, inclusivity, DEI thing. All of this stuff is designed to get everyone involved. This is the whole thing. This is why we're having this very weird woke culture. Woke culture just means the goal is to make sure that everyone on the planet is synced up on the same page. Nobody left behind. That's literally the goal. Not even one person left behind. So, but they don't want anybody feeling excluded from this ritual. Oh no, everybody participates. You come on in too. We need you too, because we're going to sync up your brainwave. We'll get you on the right microdosing of drugs. Okay, they want to make sure that everybody. They say, don't worry, whatever your personality type is, doesn't matter. We'll use the drugs to get your brainwaves in sync. So that's what woke culture is actually about. It's microdosing drug culture is what it is. Biosensor microdosing drug culture to sync brainwaves and bring about a catastrophic discouragement for perfection, so that it lets its guard down, just gets disabled and can't hide this flaw from us any longer. That's the underlying belief of all of this nonsense.